At about 12:30 a.m., Aziza woke up to the sound of her 8-month-old son Mohsin coughing badly. As she got up to attend to him, she noticed that the faint glow from the streetlight outside illuminated the room like a candle in the dark. In that dim light, she could see that the room was slowly filling up with thick, white clouds. She didn't understand what was happening. Outside, people were yelling, "Bhago! Bhago! Bhago! Run! Run! Run!" Soon, she started coughing too. Each breath seemed as if she was breathing fire. To stop the smoke from entering further, she started closing all doors and windows. But it was too late. The room was already filled with white smoke. Suddenly, Mohsin stopped coughing. He fell unconscious. In a state of panic, Aziza grabbed Mohsin in her arms, just like a mother kangaroo grabs her baby in her pouch, and rushed towards the hospital. As she neared the club, the weather outside seemed a bit strange. What was supposed to be a chilly, cold winter night didn't seem cold at all. As she neared the crowd that had gathered outside, the screams started growing louder. And as the sight became clear, what she saw next shook her to her core. Friends, what do you think she saw? Good evening, Toastmasters and guests. This is a story about an incident that changed the lives of an entire city and its future generations. It all started back in the year 1969, when Union Carbide Corporation, one of the first companies in the US to have invested in India, decided to set up a plant in the city of Bhopal. It was a win-win situation. Cheap labor for the company and employment opportunity for the city. The production started in 1979. A gas called methyl isocyanate was used to manufacture a substance commonly used in pesticides. Now, methyl isocyanate was so toxic, so lethal, and so deadly that any direct exposure to it would kill you within 72 hours. And this gas was housed in huge underground tanks right there in the factory. Now, you would expect in such a scenario, the security systems would be up to the mark? Sadly not. Year after year after year, there were cases of spillage and leakage. In fact, within a few years, nearly all security systems were malfunctioning and the pipes and valves were in poor condition. Fast forward 5 years to 2nd December 1984. It is believed that in the late evening hours, water seemed to have entered into one of those valves, which led to an intense reaction resulting in increase in temperature, increase in pressure, and leakage of the toxic gas. By 11:30 p.m., workers started to feel the effects of the exposure and started to look for the cause of the leak. But as the concrete slab on the top of the tank cracked, things went from bad to worse. The temperature continued to rise and the gas was now venting out directly into the atmosphere. Just 5 kilometers away from all this was Aziza, completely unaware of the tragedy that had befallen onto the city. Right in front of her eyes, she could see people passing out, gasping for breath, coughing uncontrollably. Some appeared to have died. Some were squatting on the streets with their eyes popping out of their sockets. Trying really hard to ignore what was happening in front of her and determined to save her son, she continued to march towards the hospital. But to her dismay, the hospital was deserted. Everyone seemed to be heading to the other side of the city. She followed them, and when she finally got there, she was relieved to see that people from adjoining areas were bringing in quilts and helping the victims. Finally relaxed, she sat on the floor with Mohsin still in her arms and soon fell unconscious. What happened next was a blur. Someone gave her food, shelter for the night, and fresh clothes. When she woke up the next day, the city seemed to have lost. Trees had shed their leaves. Food had gone bad. Milk had turned green. Everyone was stepping on top of one another to catch that last train out of the city. Somehow, Aziza got her way and managed to escape the white clouds. Today, Aziza works as a health worker in a government hospital in Bhopal and helps the survivors of the tragedy. She nearly lost her entire family on that fateful day due to blood cancer and breathing ailments that stemmed out of the exposure to that toxic gas. The suffering that fell on the city on that fateful night continues to haunt it to this day. Contamination of groundwater, breathing ailments due to exposure to toxic gas, and the never-ending fight for compensation are some of the things that continue to live even to this day. Work at the factory, however, never resumed, but the plant continues to say as a souvenir, reminding the city of the doomsday that claimed thousands of lives. And Aziza? Well, she still can't decipher how she survived with her head in the clouds. Back